NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, is the U.S. government's oldest scientific agency. NOAA's work reaches from the bottom of the sea to the surface of the sun.
In the 1960s, in the midst of the Cold War and the space race, NOAA undertook to build its most ambitious research vessel ever. This was a research vessel like no other one. It had an endurance of 150 days. It could go 20 knots with diesel-electric engines and held over 300,000 gallons of fuel, which gave it a range of some 18,000 miles. During her years of service, Oceanographer sailed over 2 million nautical miles in every major ocean. On her inaugural voyage, she transited from the U.S. East Coast to the West Coast via the North Atlantic Ocean, Mediterranean Sea, Red Sea, Indian Ocean, and Pacific. There's also a very unique observation, bulbous bow. This is a pressurized walk-in bulbous bow with observation ports below the waterline. At 92 meters, 303 feet, this vessel is roughly as long as a football field. Behind me, you'll see a blimp hangar. I'm on a helipad deck here. You could fit probably two or three twin turbine Sikorskis here, no problem. There's probably nothing quite like being on the bridge deck of a 90 meter. The view is quite spectacular. The air height of this vessel is actually 135 feet. So you gotta be careful about opening bridges. Keep in mind that this vessel was recently prepared for a transoceanic voyage. It's got a suite of new electronics. We sea trialed it, we fired up the engines. They're diesel electric, they're Westinghouse. So we've got Furuno radar, we've got Inmarsat. And we have a lot of the trusty navigational and propulsion systems of the original vessel.
The Stabbert family bought this vessel from the US government some years ago and has been taking care of it since then. CEO Dan Stabbert probably knows more about this vessel than anybody else, so let's hear what he has to say about it.
The lines are straight, the lines are clean. Real nice shape. I mean, the shape on this ship is beautiful, and it is very, very expensive to reproduce. Because it's not just visual, it's built into the structure of the ship. The flare of the bow and the rake of the bow and the rake of the stern. And it's a molded hull. You know, most vessels nowadays are a hard shine hull, and this is a molded hull. You know, a lot of the ships that were built in the last 30 or 40 years, they've chosen the least expensive build method, which means straight lines, no rake, no shear. But with this ship, you needed to have real ship fitters, and there was a real art going into this, the shape of the bottom and the bow and the way the vessel has a rake and camber. Even the decks are cambered. So there's a lot of shape and a lot of style to this, which you do not. It's just not built into ships because it's just so expensive. It probably doubles the cost of a vessel. And it was designed structurally so that it could be. You could have quite a few different interior configurations without having to worry about structure. So you have a lot of flexibility there. The ship was always maintained inside in fresh water, and once NOAA sold the vessel. She's been moored and maintained continuously in fresh water. Her steel hull is in practically new condition. I mean, just very little wastage, if any at all. She's heavily built. She is ice classed. So that means she's got special framing for the first third of the ship, special hull plating along the waterline in critical areas. Very heavily built. Vessel that is in structurally is in as new condition. I've had the vessel to 18, and that was without pushing anything hard. Actually, she's a very efficient hull. These are slow turning, very smooth. When she was running, when we were running at 18 knots, you couldn't even feel her. There was no vibration, and so quiet. So the simplest would be to put new ship's auxiliary generators in, which would be late model, auto start, you know, all fully automated. Then you could leave the existing propulsion generators and propulsion drive motors. And the propulsion drive motors are good for the life of the ship. Then the next upgrade, if you really wanted to go to the full Monty, would be to change the ship's propulsion drive generators to AC generators, dual fuel. It could be either diesel and or LNG. I would suspect it probably burns in the 2,000 to 2,400 gallon a day range at 11, between 10 and 12 knots. So it'd be very, very fuel efficient for a vessel this size.
This vessel has a barber shop. It has a medical surgery. It also has a blimp hangar. It has a huge helipad. It has a U.S. mailbox. There's an elevator here that serves four decks.
I'm in the engine room now, and one deck below me here are four Fairbanks Morse engines. Three of them are near new. They were put in by the U.S. government just before they disposed of the vessel.
This is the propulsion machinery control room for the diesel electric system. It has all the tank sounding systems for all of the tanks, main engine monitoring of temperatures and pressures, and of course all the propulsion motor controls. It was set up for an unattended engine room or remotely monitored engine room space. And for a ship of this size to have enough monitor points, have enough data checkpoints where you could really run the ship engineering-wise from this control space.
You'll see that these walls have been taken back to the insulation. Overhead, I'm gonna show you some details of the wiring. They actually stripped out the plumbing in here, but they left the base of the showers and the sink piping.
Well, why do replumbing? You know, when you got the sewage lines and all of that here. All these cables have markings on them. You know, they've got tags on them. These tags right here are numbers. All those equate to circuits. Uh-huh. Yeah, so it's relatively easy to use a circuit or to reuse a circuit.
The thing that you'll notice in these open spaces on Sahara is that there aren't a lot of structural walls. These vessels were built of to the highest government standards with the best steel and the thickest steel. This is an ice class vessel. But because of that, you can actually gut the interior and you can create huge open spaces that have great structural integrity. And there are lots of portholes and they can be made even bigger, no problem.
Very stable. Now, there is no stability issue, that's for sure. Look at this, the way this flows up, it's just beautiful. I mean, a completed vessel, I bet you would take about 4 years from the time the plans were developed, and I would suspect a cost substantially over $200 million. It wouldn't take much to have a boat like this kicking ass and doing well, operational, out cruising. Depends on how fancy it went on the interiors, but come on, 16 staterooms plus crew quarters and then new galley and all of that.
When you get into vessels over, let's say 60 meters, 200 feet, and you start to get up to the size of this vessel, which is 92 meters, 300 feet. I think you're really not talking about a yacht anymore. You're talking about a ship finished to yacht quality. So I just wanted to make that distinction and point out that here in Seattle, they are very adept at dealing with ocean-going ships. And this is not a bad choice.
I suspect, you know, you could do this in a shorter time frame as a year, 12 months. And if you're going to go more extensively, a more extensive refit with full fairing and changing up main propulsion engines and so forth, you would need probably another year, take you about 18 to 20 months.
All I can say is you better come see it, because you cannot believe it unless you come see it. So call me up and I'll show it to you.